Orbit Recycling, a space startup from Berlin, Germany, was founded in 2018 with the idea of collecting orbital debris in Earth's orbit. Instead of sending debris into the Earth's atmosphere, where it will burn up, they have a better plan. Why not use a space tug to push the debris straight at the moon? By crashing orbital debris into a designated impact zone on the moon, and then melting down materials into metal ingots, construction materials are sent to the moon at a lower cost than from Earth, while cleaning up low Earth orbit of dangerous derelicts. Orbital debris is a huge pain for satellite operators, or any company that needs access to space. It's estimated the cost to space operators is €14 million annually in evasion maneuvers and up to $1 billion in insurance premiums. This idea aligns with space agencies around the world, in particular NASA and ESA, who have good reasons to want orbital debris removed so they can continue to access space in a safe manner. Orbital debris by mass is mostly aluminium. It's by far the most abundant material used in upper stages because of its strength and low weight. It's true that the moon contains plenty of aluminium, but it's chemically bound to oxygen and other elements, so it requires a great deal of energy to separate. Using recycled aluminium from spent upper stages is cheaper and simpler. Aluminium represents approximately 50% of the composition of upper stages by mass, with stainless steel and titanium making about 25% of the mass, mostly as propellant tanks and engine parts. Copper and some other metals make up between 5 to 8%, with composites and plastics around 15%. Other components such as batteries, optics and explosives make up the remaining 5 to 10%. An Ariane 5 upper stage in orbit contains 4 to 5 tons of high-grade aluminium. Orbital Recycling estimates that spent upper stages from European rockets contains over 150 tons of aluminium. In total, a reasonable guess for the amount of aluminium floating in near-Earth orbit is around 5,000 tons. Aluminium is overwhelmingly the most valuable and recyclable material in space. To give an example of how useful recycled orbital debris could be on the moon, a single Ariane or Falcon 9 upper stage has enough aluminium to fabricate a pressure shell for a 50 cubic meter habitat module, or pave a 60 meter by 60 meter dust-free landing pad that's 10 centimeters or 4 inches thick, or produce 15 kilometers of aluminium power cable. That's one upper stage. Frank Kosch, a German physicist and founder of Orbital Recycling, claims that billions of dollars in launch costs can be saved by recycling existing materials in space. ESA is working on an active removal program for space debris. The problem is expensive. And while Europe can remove its own satellites, along with NASA removing old US satellites, both Russia and China don't appear to have any interest in removing their own spent upper stages. In fact, China is still continuing to launch rockets that leave uncontrolled and dangerous upper stages in orbit, so the problem is getting worse, not better. Building a lunar base on the moon will be expensive because sending 1 ton of any material will cost around $500 million. With an operational starship, that may eventually drop to $100 million, but no lower. That's still a huge amount of money for 1 ton of material. Using materials that are already in orbit takes only about 3.2 kilometers per second for a hard crash on the moon, while sending materials from Earth to a soft lunar landing requires about 16 kilometers per second, vastly more delta V. This is because orbital debris has already paid most of the price in delta V when it was launched into space. A single tug could divert 5 to 10 large tumbling objects towards the moon on a single fuel tank, crashing them into the moon for post-impact melting. With orbiting propellant stations, a large fleet of space tugs could rain down materials onto the lunar surface for a fraction of the price of Earth supply missions. Using NASA's orbital debris models, a fleet of 20 to 50 space tugs could divert 500 high-risk objects, representing 80% of the collision risk, to the moon within a decade. Poincaré Basin. Poincaré Basin, located on the far side of the moon, stands out as one of the best sites for controlled, high-velocity crashes of orbital debris, according to an independent lunar site selection study by NASA. The basin has low scientific value, 250 km diameter with a depth of 4 km to contain any ejecta from impacts. A low slope of under 3 degrees for easy access and exit. Extremely cold, which preserves volatiles such as propellants, near highlands that receive plenty of sunlight and are a good location for processing of materials from the wreckage. Rovers would periodically enter the crater to collect debris for processing. Modelling suggests over 90% of the ejecta from a crash would stay within the basin. After a decade of crashes, the location would be a valuable metal mine of aluminium, titanium and copper, easily accessible with a small fleet of smelter rovers. Construction materials delivered to the moon. Assuming a 90% capture success, a space tug fleet can divert thousands of tons of mass to the moon. With aluminium at 45% of the total mass, which is conservative, almost 1,000 tons of usable aluminium ingots or powder can be recycled for lunar construction. That is enough aluminium to produce 10 to 15 habitat modules with a pressurized area of 50 cubic meters each, or 1 square kilometer of dust-free landing pads. The cost will likely be in the 3 billion euro range, saving 10 to 15 billion in Earth supply missions for the same material, and this is assuming Starship's lower costs for moon delivery. Orbit Recycling has developed an initial casting prototype that can produce large objects with dimensions of up to 4 by 5 meters. Casts can be made from shaped regolith that is sintered to make the mold hard. Then molten aluminium is poured into the cast to create the part or component, made of pure aluminium, or mixed with regolith to produce a mixed compound. Fresnel lenses are used to focus sunlight to create intense heat to melt aluminium or other metals. Temperatures of over 1,100 degrees Celsius can be reached, which is high enough to melt aluminium. Space Tug Scenario 10-Year Cleanup Project. Here is an example of using a fleet of space tugs to clean up 500 high-risk objects floating in space. The project will divert these objects to an impact zone on the moon. Post-impact smeltering of the wreckage will create, over time, thousands of tons of high-grade metals for lunar construction. I will use space startups that have operational vehicles or are close to demonstrating the necessary technology. For the space tug, I use Impulse Space's Mira, a flight-proven orbital transfer vehicle which is ideal for pushing orbital debris towards the moon, assuming the necessary capture technology has been developed. In this scenario, a fleet of 40 Mira-class tugs, each of which is refueled quarterly by a fleet of orbit far propellant stations. Each station holds 2,000 kilos of propellant, such as nitrous oxide and ethane, that the Mira tug uses. 500 objects diverted to the moon would be over 3,000 tons of material, of which roughly half would be aluminium. This would reduce the impact risk of collisions in low Earth orbit by 80%. Over time, nearly all large debris objects could be diverted to the moon and recycled for lunar base construction. Diversion versus Earth supply for lunar construction. Diversion is exponentially cheaper than Earth's supply of materials at scale. Analysis suggests diversion tips the scale at just over 1 ton of material supplied to the moon. As an example, the European Envisat satellite consists of over 3.5 tons of aluminium. With space tugs that refuel in orbit, the diversion of Earth orbiting materials to the moon becomes even more compelling. Challenges: impacts must be targeted precisely to avoid damaging assets already on the moon. Orbital debris is still property that has an owner. It can't be moved without permission and probably payment of salvage rights. Space agencies and government-owned assets may allow free removal to clear up space. Final thoughts. Every derelict upper stage we crash on the moon can become the framing, wiring, shielding and landing pads for the first permanent lunar base. Orbital debris is converted into lunar infrastructure while clearing up space at the same time. What do you think about the idea of collecting orbital debris around Earth and crashing it into the moon to recycle aluminium into useful parts? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space news video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week, or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with previews of upcoming content. If you've got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.